Then I will build some tools, Bayesian theorem, we'll use Bayes theorem, and we'll show an ARN example to actually draw some analogy to the posterior distribution. Then we'll introduce hierarchical Bayes. Then again, we'll introduce MCMC and two special tools in MCMC so that we can do the data analysis for our data. So, camera trapping is a particular type of sampling where data are obtained in the form of images. So, cameras are often situated along trails in the nature reserves or at better stations. So, whenever an individual comes in the vicinity of the cameras, they get photographed. Then, researchers collect those photographs and either manually or by using the software ExtraCompare, identifies all those unique distinct individuals. So, camera trapping methods are widely used for species that have unique stripe or spot patterns, like tigers, spotted leopards, and some other cat species. So, this is the map of Nagarhole Reserve, where you can see that these black dots are actually camera trap stations. There are 120 such camera trap stations, and each of them were active for 12 consecutive nights. The quantities of interest are how many such individuals are there and what are their capture probabilities, that means the detection probabilities, and how much they move, kind of a measure of dispersion. Now, the kind of data we have is like an array of ones and zeros. So, only those who get captured, they get identified. We get those capture histories and arrange in some way so that we can get our estimates. So, the data are Bernoulli variables where the probability parameter is individual specific. That means for every individual, we have a particular probability of capturing. We also use another data which can be used as covariates also, like location of different camera traps. This actually helps in identifying the activity area for each of these individuals. Now, we will talk about a classical Bayes theorem, which is used nowadays everywhere. So, probability of A given B is obtained by three different probabilities. That is, probability of B given A, probability of A divided by the probability of B. And probability of B can be calculated as a sum of two different probabilities. The first term is actually B's occurring with A. Second term is actually the event B occurred, but the event A didn't occur. I will talk about an example to explain the theorem. Suppose we have an ARN, we have four red balls, two green balls. The experiment is such that two balls are to be randomly drawn, one after the another, without replacement. So, there are two events. The first ball is drawn and the second ball is drawn. Now, to find the probability that the first ball is drawn, when it is given that second ball is also drawn, probability of A given B, that is what we want to know. So, probability of A is probability of that the first ball is straight. So, we already knew that there are four red balls and two green balls. So, total number of balls are six. So, the probability of A is six. Now, probability of A complement, which is first ball is green, is 2/6. Now, we also compute the probability of B given A, which is, we know that the first ball is red, then what is the probability of the second ball is also red? Now, there are, since we already drawn one red ball, we have only three red balls, and the total number of balls has reduced to 5. And probability of A given B complement, that means the first ball is green, what is the probability that the second ball is red? That is 4/5. Now, we already talked that B can happen in two ways. B can happen with either A or A had not occurred, but B occurred. So, using these three different quantities, that probability A we have computed, probability B we have also computed, and probability of B given A we have also computed. So, using these three, we compute probability of A given B. Now, how to formulate that in the real world problem? So, this, I will draw an analogy, like ARN is a world and it is unknown. Somehow we got to know that there are four red balls and two green balls. but we don't have much belief on it. So it kind of information which has been given to us, but we want to improve that knowledge based on the event of obtaining a red ball when we have already observed data that second ball is red. So we want to improve our knowledge that obtaining a red ball the first draw based on the given data. So it's a different version of the same theorem. We have data on endpoints. The model for the data is given as the conditional distribution of data given the parameter. The parameter is the true state of nature on which we have just a prior belief pi theta, which has been expressed in a probability statement. And what we want to do that improve our prior knowledge based on the given observation. So that is the distribution of the posterior, that means the probability of theta given the value y, which is the data. Again, we need to compute these three quantities to get to the posterior distribution. So the aspect of Pei's approach that people like, that nothing is ad hoc. Probability calculation are used for everything. That means estimation of mean, estimation of variance, estimation of different quantiles, other moments. So probability approach has been used for everything. But the things that people don't like, why Bayes is not popular among frequentists. That means how do you get the knowledge? What is prior probability? How can you expect a non-technical user to formulate this probability statement? Now, the prior represents your subjective beliefs by a probability statement about a set of values, and you know, and you can tell that which set of values are more likely to occur than the other set of values, or you can give a likely range of all those parameters. But the inference is basically subjective. If you fix a prior, all the inferences will be conditional on that prior itself. So basically what the basic statement is, your prior is your prior. You and the other person will observe the same data, but using different prior will be lead to different conclusion. So basically if you have a prior information, you should use it. If you don't have a prior information, there is no unique way to specify the prior distribution. And this is a very vast area of research. People have been devising different methodology to fix the priors, how to fix a prior when you don't have any information. There are semi-informative prior, there are non-informative priors, and so on. It's still a very lively area of research. So, and this flexibility makes Bayes' approach more applicable to real-world problems. That means if you have some information, you can actually use it to improve your knowledge on the parameter. Now I will talk about hierarchical modeling. Now, you can see at the topmost level, there is a collection of truths, which we don't know. Then there are some layers from which every layer proceeds, and then there we observe the data. So before observing data, there are certain truth layers, and then we go to the top. So the data we observe is actually the outcome of a different process model. The process also depends on some other process models. Then they are depend on some certain parameters. So this is a hierarchy of different populations and their distributions. So basically the posterior distribution is a, but we don't know anything about them. So we want to know the parameters and the process given that we observe the data only. So it's a hierarchy that the data given the process and parameters, then the model of the process, then the parameters. Yeah. So can see. Now I want to introduce Markov chain. It's a random process. That means every transition from every state will depend on some particular probability. If that particular chain satisfies Markov probability, then we'll call it a Markov chain. So Here we can see that there are two states, A and B. From A, no, we can't do that. So what we actually seeing is there are two states. From A, it can go to B or it can remain in A, but the time will move. So it's a series of A's and B's and combination of both. But from the state A, if it goes to probability state B, it has certain probability attached to it. So you can see that it can remain in the state A with probability 0.6, but it can go to B with probability 0.4. So the total probability has to be 1. On the B is the same thing. It can stay in B with probability 0.3, or it can go to A with probability 0.7. Now, here it is the most simplest situation. You have only two states. In real world problem, you have multiple states. So, the motivation of Markov chain Monte Carlo is to compute certain parameters, which will actually give you insight of the posterior distribution. Problem is, the posterior distribution may not be standard. That means it may not be Poisson, it may not be the general distribution like normal or gamma or beta. It will only have a functional form attached to it. So how to get some knowledge from that particular functional form? If you have a long enough sample, then you can actually quantify certain quantities from that distribution. Like these are, the second is the posterior mean, the third one is the variance, posterior variance. The first one is the marginal distribution of data. This is also a very hard problem to crack, to how to compute that quantity. So ultimately we are doing it in three steps. We get the long chain. We satisfy some particular conditions like irreducibility, aperiodic and positive recurrence. Irreducibility means that from any state, it can go to any state. So the probability of going from any state to any other state is non-zero. Aperiodic means the minimum number of steps that it need to go to any state is 1. Positive recurrence means the minimum returning time to the same state has a positive probability, and the mean returning time is actually finite. So our quantity of interest can be a function of theta, which can be approximated by this arithmetic mean, simple arithmetic mean. Then if you want to get some kind of a valid confidence for that particular estimate, we can compute the Monte Carlo standard error using either bootstrap or jackknife or some other non-parametric methods. Here, I will show that if we want to use those chains, they had to be valid for that posterior distribution. So here you can see we have three different starting points of three different chains. One is purple, one is red, one is blue. But ultimately, after some iterations, they all get to cluster. And you can see there are some multiple posterior density. That means from the initial points, things hasn't converged. But as it goes, like 10,000 iteration, you can see a unique posterior density. That means all the chains has reached to a same point. That means all have converged. Now, there are specific tools from MCMC that how do we actually sample from that distribution. Now, here we started with that long chain. Problem is how to get that chain. So, there are different, I will be talking about only two, like Gibbs sampling. The name is pretty much famous. So, what we do, we break the parameter set into different clusters. Like here we broke into theta 1, theta, theta 3 parameter set. Now, we factor out all the functional form which depends on those theta 1 from the joint posterior distribution. And then we sample from them, if we get to sample. They also can be non-standard. trigon can also be just a functional form. In those cases, we use Metropolis Hastings. Just draw some sample from some known distribution. Then, if that particular sample satisfies a particular condition, this is the R is given the condition, then we accept that. Otherwise, reject. Otherwise, the chain doesn't move. So, what is actually doing, if the sample which can be obtained from some other distribution, then we accept. Otherwise, that particular state remains on the same. Now, I will do the data analysis using these tools. So, just a quick recap that we had 120 camera traps and both of all of them are active for 12 consecutive nights. The area of the minimum triangle containing those camera traps are 679.4 km that Arjun just mentioned. Our model is a 10 data, which is a binomial model made out of Bernoullis. And the capture probability is a function of three different parameters like P0, sigma and SI. Now, what is SI? SI is a particular latent variable which has been attached to each of these individuals. So, each of these individuals are very active around the whole reserve. If we assign a particular location on those particular activity center, then we call it the activity center. So, each of these individuals are mobile. We just assign a single point for those activity area. So, for each of them, we assign such SIs. We call it them the activity center. Now, PI will be dependent on SI because if those individuals are actually away from the camera trap, the capture probability will be low. And if those individuals are very near to those camera traps, then obviously the capture probability will get high because they will be around the cameras all the time. In such way, we got 45 number of distinct individuals. Now, this is the capture probability, so very vague maybe. So, the latter part, what it actually means that if the distance of that particular individual is very much away from the camera traps, xk are the camera trap locations, then the probability will be very low. And P0 is the interpretation. The interpretation of P0 is such that probability of capture for the most exposed individual. That means if an individual lies around the center of this whole camera trap array, then that particular individual has the largest probability of getting captured. Now, to the modeling part. So, we just assign some prior distribution for each of these parameters. Like our activity center, since we don't have any information, we use the uniform prior for that. The sigma is a dispersal parameter. We use uniform again, but again we fix the range there. You see 0 to 5. That means we fix that it cannot go beyond 0 to 5 unit. And the probability of the most exposed individual is uniform from 0 to 1 because it's a probability. Data augmentation is a part of the hierarchical model. We think that there is a superpopulation from which our population is a subset of it. And then we get another subset which are our captured individual. So, there is a three layer, that's the assumption. From the superpopulation, some individuals can be a part of the population or may not. Those we call the pseudo individuals. So, this particular parameter ZIs is a individual if the ith member, if it is the ith member of the population. This is a Bernoulli parameter, but the thing is, we never get to observe this. These are the latent variables. We never get to observe this, but this is part of the process. We get to estimate them. The model of the captured data is again the binomial that I described before. But the thing is, if the individual, the ith individual is and part of the population, then yi can be 1s or 0s. But the thing is, if they are not, if zi is 0, that means ith individual is not a part of the population, then the detection will be always zero. So this we will use in the actual setup. Sorry for this. So actually, we have the joint density, joint posterior density there. Now, if we just take all the factors which depends on these different parameters, we want to do the Gibbs sampling. Now, we can see this, all of them, that F, the F function is actually product of Bernoulli's. Pi of P naught is actually uniform, which is a constant. So, product of them will never give some standard distribution for P naught. Same for sigma, same for the activity centers. But for Z's, we will get some standard distribution. If we have a non-detected individual, then the ZIs will follow Bernoulli, and if we have a detection, then obviously this is a part of the population. If you have a detection, that means that that individual is there. So ZI will be always 1. And CI depends on the parameters psi, and psi will give this kind of posterior return. This is also a standard distribution. Using this, so we have assumed the superpolar population as consist of 845 individuals, but we have only got 45 among them. So the remaining are all zero capture histories. So using these 845 capture histories and discretizing the state space S among 10,000 potential activity centers, we can do the MCMC and get to this result. So, the number of individuals in that minimum rectangle is 91 with a standard deviation of 15. And density, this density is actually the number of individuals per 100 square kilometer. That is 13.5 based on this study. Now, using the same data, there are several other studies also getting several other different results. So, the point is, if you do the modeling right, you will, more often than not, you will get a proper value answer. So, here this study is actually mentioned is in Arjun's paper and also in the book by Royal and Dorazio. And I just explained that. Thank you.
So, I mean, so this was the theory part of it that we explained how it worked. So, just wanted to understand if what were the tools that you used and, you know, how much time it took to analyze the data.
Yeah, sure. So, and, this particular analysis was done in Winbox, where if you just fix the priors and the data and the initial value of the chain, you will get the posterior estimates within some 4 to 5 hours. But the thing is, this data is not that big because there are only 12 consecutive nights and 120 camera types and 45 captured individuals. But if you do it in JAGS, it will take some more time. If you do it in R, you can do it much more faster. R has the flexibility of doing it customizing. That means it can go outside the standard distribution also, and you can customize the thing by doing a proper coding or something like that. But I'm not a natural coder. But Winbox is a very good way of doing that.
Hello. My name is Naveen. I had a doubt.
Hi. Okay.
I had a doubt from the previous session also.
From the?
Previous session, which continues in this session also.
Okay.
So, one of the things I observed is that you make a generalization for the Bernoulli distribution. That
generalization? What kind of?
Yeah, so the beta distribution is a generalization to the binomial, right?
Beta distribution?
Beta is a distribution that's a generalization to the binomial, right?
No.
Can
beta
you...
is a distribution for the parameter, the probability parameter.
Yeah, so what you do basically is to add an extra parameter to it and then make your estimation fit that parameter so that the entire data, it fits to the data.
Okay.
So you are basically doing an estimation that fits best set of parameters along with the beta distribution. Am I clear or should I repeat it?
Yeah, you should.
All right. So basically we are doing an estimation on a cost function.
Okay,
on the data set, right?
Okay.
Which will give an estimate for the alpha and beta parameters in the beta distribution. You do something similar in this talk also. So
yes.
My question is, if I say derive a generalized distribution over say any JLM that I have, and say
generalized distribution over every JLM,
any one particular JLM that I have, and say fit a set of an additional parameter and give it an extra degree of freedom, do you think it will be a better fit to the data?
No.
Always, or is it in specific cases a better fit? Because
see,
I observed it in the previous talk. That's why I have this very specific doubt.
See, if you do a generalization, it should be specific on the particular problem. It should fit all the assumptions set that you have fit. Otherwise, this is not a generalization. You want to speak about it?
Since it probably relates to my session also. So, what are we doing here? We are actually trying to characterize the reality on the ground, which is filtered by the observation process. And like I said, it has to become a joint model. Together, we are viewing something together. It's not by parts. And the survey design is made such that all the parameters are estimable. So in the sense, we said there is no problem of identifiability. So, for example, when I showed you that index calibration experiment where the beta distribution came in, we just saw a set of data, right? Now, the point you're trying to say is, now, let me go on adding parameters to, let's say, a simple regression and see which fits the model best. The point we are trying to make here is, we cannot add parameters like that to fit these models. We call that overfitting. What we instead are recommending is we break it into a hierarchy such that the two processes are entirely different. So what the capability you will get is, suppose observation process is driven by completely something else. For example, like I said, the observation process for the tiger example was based on substrate type. So I'll put that as what we call a covariate. Now what do I put that as a covariate to? I can't put that to the ecological process because substrate has got nothing to do with tiger density. But it had a lot to do with how I see and how data are coming to me. So when you break it into two parameters like that, we form the hierarchy. So that's the central point here.
So there do you assume conditional independence then?
Now it depends. If they are they are meant to be independent parameters, but you will have situations, as I gave in the tiger example, that they are actually related not by choice, just by chance. That tigers are at very high densities in parks, and it also so happens that you can see tracks better there. But if you have broken them into two parameters, I can put the covariate separately for the two without a problem in this hierarchical approach. Otherwise, the problem you will face is you're just going to add. And when you add parameters to a regression, which is normally done, we start violating. We still have this problem of identifiability that comes in. I hope that sort of clarifies.
I have a question. So, like most probably, hello.
Hi.
Most probably, we'll start with a wrong prior. So, as we keep on adding more and more data, will the effect of choosing a wrong prior reduce?
Okay, good question. Actually, if your data is large enough, or if your data has better information on the particular parameter, then the whatever prior you take should not influence. But again, if your prior is too much strong for the data, it's not advisable.
But like if we keep on adding data for years, then and we keep on deriving posterior, and the posterior acts as a prior for the next posterior.
Yeah, these kind of methods are actually there. The way you are saying that it's a time series, it's actually each time point is whatever you are actually getting the estimates, you can use it for the next time point as a product. Yeah, these kind of models are there still.
Like this isn't it how it should be done? Like if you get some data, add a prior, get a posterior, then add some more data, that posterior and data, you get the next posterior.
No, see, obviously this is one way. There is another way that you get a, you use all these past events, past data accumulated, not as a Markov chain.
And
then
you
come up use
with a new prior. You can also come up with a new prior based on the data you
have. There are the different customizable ways.
Okay.
I just thought I could clarify what he was trying to make. Maybe it answers you better. I think you were referring to what we call in Bayesian statistics is this. You are talking about this procedure called stepwise updating, but you need to be careful. What are you updating? Now, suppose your process actually undergoes a change. Say stocks, for example, you see fluctuations, but you might be seeing a trend, and typically that's how it's used, these approaches. Not for the kind of problems we do, because the kind of problems we do more detailed modeling. We look at individuals, see which comes out, which goes in, and we estimate different sets of parameters. But the kind of problem you're talking about is this stock rising or stock declining. There is a big fluctuation. There is year-to-year autocorrelation. Now, if I blindly do stepwise updating and keep shrinking the posterior, you will go wrong because you're not taking both the autocorrelation into concern, as well as you have to account for the fact that the last year's stock prices of a certain share need not be that tomorrow, and we are going to take an uncertainty in there, right? So to answer you more precisely, I think it'll be a mixture of two processes. There will be some updation that will happen in this Bayesian updating. But the larger deal in this whole thing is that you need to get that process right. So whether you use ARIMA models, ARMA models, all these time series, various models, right? Whatever you take to be ideal, that model you should not change. You can't update that. I hope that sort of answers.
This is more related to the problem that you addressed here. So when you were defining the binary variable yij, right? So it was ith individual in the jth instance, right? So why aren't we considering a k factor, right, captured by which camera?
Yeah, actually, see, this is a particular study. These kind of studies are also there where we actually use more, and which actually increases the dimension of the whole array. Sometimes it gives better answer. Sometimes it is actually more cumbersome or more time-taking process also. And sometimes it leads to a bad result. So here it's more or less easier to do. That's why I explained that.
Yeah, but say if a particular tiger in this case is captured by multiple cameras on a given instance. So it's like you take that to be only one, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
This will be totally orthogonal from the discussion that happened, but on the similar lines, I just want to note the field of your study was tigers. You're right. If that could be the camera image in the signal camera images in the city, so with that thing, a traffic prediction, any modeling has been attempted or something like that, we can predict the traffic with the bank.
I don't actually work on these kind of things, but I don't know. Because if they are more or less individual specific, that means you get to know all these different networks individually and get the proper data or proper covariates, then I think it should be modeled. But I think it's more or less based on signal processing, right?
With, I thought with the images available from all the things, we will be able to, from the all the images, historical images we are available, we will be able to just predict or something we can do about the traffic study, and then that's what I
see. I don't, not able to get the actual problem there, but I think that if you're able to distinguish all of them, and make them properly modeled, then I think you'll be able to do that. But I am not an expert of that degree.
just a cluttered signal would do actually little, since most of the signals in Bangalore is covered, so you can outer ring road traffic can be just studied actually from the given the points that is happening on the North Bangalore on the one single stretch. I'm just giving, I am not, maybe it's wild thought.
See, these ideas, actually the idea of capture recapture originally came with P.S. Laplace in 1780s. He looked at birth registers in churches in France to estimate the population of France. The next application was for fish in Denmark. You mark some fish, you release them, you recapture. From the proportion of fish marked in the recaptured sample, you estimate the detection probability in some sense. Then ducks, hunted ducks and banded ducks in night. So this original idea was to actually mark the animal. So the photographies, we are using natural marks. It's very interesting you say that. One of the early capture-recapture models was developed in Edinburgh, doing exactly the thing you are saying. There's guys noting down taxi numbers in different parts of Edinburgh and estimating the total number of taxis in Edinburgh using capture-recapture. One issue about the continued data is that, one fundamental assumption in this capture-recapture is that you are sampling a population in a very short time, in a snapshot. So during that snapshot, the numbers are not changing. So when you use the next year's data to answer that, this information may go as a low-quality prior, what your previous estimate was, but you have to again repeat the experiment and take another snapshot. And there was talk about what if you don't have prior information at all. So he talked about non-informative priors, in which case this method converges to pure likelihood. Thank you.
Very simple question. I've seen people acquire priors in questionable ways. So for example, in a previous setting, the goal was to estimate the probability of success of a coin toss, and let's say you have 10 different coins, each one of them has a different PI, and the way they got, and you only have two tosses for each coin, and the way they constructed the prior was to take the 20 coin tosses as one population and estimate beta distribution from that. So that's obviously wrong, it's bad, because you also have the particular coin that you're interested in, say coin, the first coin,
yeah,
P1.
The coins are heterogeneous, yeah.
Right, they're heterogeneous. I mean, you sort of do believe that they have similarity. Even if they're heterogeneous, you do believe they have similarity. My problem with that was, you want to estimate, you want to get a better estimate for P1, which is for the first coin, but you build your prior including the two coin tosses from P1 into the beta distribution data.
So you want to improve your prior distribution as you go on. That's what you were saying.
So you want to get a better rest. So you have a coin, say C1, and you can get from the two tosses of C1, you can get an estimate for, you can get hat of P1, just using that two
so
data
using
points.
Using just the two tosses.
Yeah, but you want to do better than that by using beta binomial model. And so where do you get your beta distribution from? You take for all the 10 coins together, you treat them as if they were one homogeneous population related to this particular coin.
Good.
And you get the beta distribution. Does that make sense?
No, then you should know what is the parameters of the beta distribution. There are different ways to estimate those parameters. They are called actually hyperparameters.
That's right.
So
alpha and beta.
Alpha and beta.
That's
so
right.
One way to estimate that is empirical ways, where you actually integrate over P and get as a function of alpha and beta.
Right.
And you maximize your likelihood
right.
to get the estimate for those.
Right.
And the other thing is, you give another model for those two parameters.
So this was going via the empirical route. My problem was that they were including the data for the coin in question, the coin of interest, C1. They were including that data into the estimation of the beta distribution for the prior, if that makes sense.
They're using that data to the estimation of parameters.
Yeah, they're using it for the estimation of alpha and beta, and they're also using it for the likelihood.
So, this is a double fold thing.
Yes, so, exactly.
Exactly.
So what would have been a better way to go about this? Because it seems to me this is wrong. I mean,
See, empirical base is useful in very much multidimensional ways. That means, suppose if the number of parameters are very high, then using a population for all those parameters is very time taking and is very complex also. Then using that to actually improve your prior knowledge on those parameters makes sense.
Okay.
Because you will be actually improving your time. But in this case, because you have very small data, it is not advisable, I would say.
So you said if it had been, say, 100 coins, then you would have been okay with this procedure.
This is very experiment specific. So 100, 200, then you can say 1000.
So okay. 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 Thanks.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Okay.
Thank you, Soman.